Hi, peace, love, happiness. I thought I'd go and tell a story that's a little bit lighter than the ones I've been telling. I do have to talk about child abuse because once we get rid of that, we'll have world peace. But I thought I would talk a little bit about writing the musical Hair. Hair opened in 1967. I just read a review of it. It blew Broadway's mind, so the reviews were bad, but I kept telling everybody in it and associated with it that the reviews will be bad. And that's a good thing, because then people will know it's not your usual Broadway play. And the reviews were, they weren't bad, they weren't good, but you know, nobody had ever put rock into Broadway before, and so much of it, 27 songs to be exact. So it was all kinds of good fun, and the people who lived in the area thought that the hippies were taking over. You know, they said, we heard this is happening in San Francisco, and now it's happening here too. And I had some people come up, like when we would take a break, I would go outside and hang out outside for a while and then go back into the theater. And these two young girls one time asked me if I saw a boy named Frank Hill, and I said, I'm not from around here, and I don't know anybody around here. And she went on to describe this boy who wore gold chains on his leather jacket, and on the back written the words Mary and Mom and Hell's Angels, and he wore a white crash helmet. I thought, like, this guy sounds like a keeper. So I wrote a song about it, just because I thought, you know, girls are so ridiculously desperate that they'll date anybody who winks at them, you know? They're just ridiculous, and our standards are so low. And I thought it was really hysterically funny the way she described this guy. I thought, I gotta write a song about this one. So, but what happened was, here, I should start it now. This is it. I'm going to play it in the background while I talk. What happened was, later on, I saw the boy, and because I remembered the description because I had written it down as a song, and I went to talk to him about the girl, and he and his friend pulled a knife out on me, and they said they would cut her up if she talks to people about him. They were really nasty boys. I lost his address. So I guess I can't talk over it. But then when I saw her again, I said, you stay away from that boy. You know, I told her his friend pulled a knife on me. And so the song is called Frank Mills, and it's on the Hair soundtrack album. And so they asked me where I'd been sleeping, and I said, generally in my bed. And it turned out they were homeless, and they were about my age. One was a little bit older, but again, I just turned 15 in August. So I would have been either 14 or 15 when I met them. And so I asked them why. And I knew I had to go back in. I knew I was going to be late, but I figured I better help these girls, because they're trying to make friends with guys who are going to cut them up. You know, this is not good. So it turned out that one girl ran away because that she was living in a house of horrors. They were really abusive, and like, their let their friends rape her, and just like she was like the Cinderella that really there was no upside to her life. But the other girl, what ran away because she had a fight with her mother. I think she wanted to get a job, and her mother told her she was too young or something, so she ran away, which I thought was really stupid of the parents. Why would, if your kid wants to get a job, pat him on the back. So I said, well, let me call. You girls can't live here on the streets. I thought briefly I could let them stay in the theater, but then they would probably kill me. I mean, I'm sure it was illegal. So I called her parents. Meanwhile, the time is ticking away. I'm now about half an hour late, and the director really should not be late. And so then I talked her mother into come and pick her up and her friend. I kept saying, you've got to get this other girl off the streets. This girl's not going to make it a year. She'll be dead within a year if you leave her. And if you can't take her into your house, at least try to find her, a halfway house or someplace where she could live. So then I got back to the theater, and everybody was so mad. By this time, I must have been probably 40 minutes late, and they were mad. And I just kept saying, well, I had to help somebody. It couldn't be helped. I had to be late because I had to help somebody. And sure enough, her parents came, picked her up. Then they came back on opening night and told everybody the story. And everybody in the cast was like, all she said was she had to help somebody. We didn't know she was out there changing lives. And some of the cast said, well, we knew she was like that. Listen to the songs. And so it really, that kind of publicity was the thing that sold the show, that my heart was really in to peace, love, and understanding. And I think that people listened to it with a new ear when they realized that I was for real. I think that it should be replayed. It should be brought out of dusted off and redone every year for a weekend. Because unfortunately, a lot of it I didn't achieve. I've had about 30,000 people pushing back who want war, but I'm still plugging along. And unfortunately, things like racism and sexism and war is still in abundance. It still plagues our country. Our country will never be great if we can't get rid of those ills. So what I think what I'll do is I will put this on and a copy of the song so you can hear the song. But like I said, I just wrote it because I thought it was funny and turned out to be something that really saved her life, saved their lives. The mother was really happy that everything worked out so well. So, peace.